An inertial frame, so is the thirst of knowledge of a student, is controlled by the orientation of curiosity, which is instilled by the guidance of a teacher. So, to take this workshop forward, we have M. Venkata Rao sir with us. I would like to request Venkata Rao sir to come forward and take us all to the journey of space and technology on the topic attitude sensor.
Good afternoon. In this session, first presentation, actually this session, we will be dealing with an important topic of the any satellites, nano or big, that is attitude and orbit control system, okay, which controls the satellite attitude, okay, which is very important because the payload, okay, to meet the payload requirement, to point to the whatever destination, whatever target is required to point. So this session is there. So basically, in an attitude control system, there will be three elements. One is a sensor which measures the attitude. Then comes the next is the control electronics, okay, with the required software, okay, which will sense this error, and then it will give a signal to actuators, okay. So actuators will act, okay, correct the error, try to correct and bring the pointing to the required orientation. So that is the basic configuration. So first I will talk on sensors. Mr. Natarajan will explain on the control aspects, how the control dynamics as well as control electronics, how it will work. And then one of the actuators, okay, the most important, that is the propulsion system. That's also an actuator. Okay, that will be dealt by Mr. Prasad.
See, earlier also some of the presentations, you were shown the pictures of a satellite with the axis definition, okay. Each satellite will have three axes, roll axis, pitch axis, and yaw axis. Then in general convention, the roll axis is the velocity vector. The satellite is going like this, this is the roll axis. The axis pointing towards nadir, towards the earth, okay, for earth imaging or earth oriented payloads, okay, or atmospheric, whatever it is, which has to point towards earth, that axis is called yaw axis. So you have defined two axes, roll axis, yaw axis, and the third perpendicular axis is pitch axis. That is the basic definition. So you have three axes. So for the three axes, you have to control the three axes. All the satellites are three axis stabilized, we call it. So all the three axes have to be controlled. So you will have a set of sensors, we call it attitude sensor. Actually, any satellite will have two types of sensors broadly. One is the attitude sensors, other one is the monitoring sensors for the satellite. Mr. Gupta has presented temperature sensors, pressure sensors, okay. They are all for the monitoring the health of the satellite. Attitude sensors are to measure the attitude errors. So in a satellite, if you see, sensors will be mounted. For example, in this satellite, in the top, you are seeing a star sensor, okay. There will be a magnetometer, warning, explained. There will be sun sensors, 4-5 sun sensors is mounted on a, you can see there, on a small vertical bracket, the 4-5 sun sensor, like that different sensors are mounted in different orientations. The most important thing is, once you, first of all, you have to a priori decide where to mount each sensor, okay, and there is some reasons behind it, criteria behind that. You cannot mount wherever you like. One is, first of all, you have to clear the field of view. The sensor has to see an object, a sun or a star, okay, or whatever it is. Something should not come into the field of view. Okay. And then you have to define the references with respect to satellite axis, whatever roll, pitch, yaw. The sensor, where sensor is pointing, what is the relation between the two? Okay, this also you have to define a priori. In fact, after mounting the sensors, maybe a word called alignment was used earlier, tomorrow also to be used. So the what is meant by alignment is, we measure the actual sensor axis, okay, sensor, star sensor means star sensor will have an axis, okay, that axis to this our satellite roll pitch axis, what is the relation, what is the angle, what is the error, okay, that alignment, because while mounting there may be some you know, exact ideal mounting may not be there because of some mechanical errors, etc. So the but we have to know what is the error between ideal mounting and actual mounting, that is called alignment. So why first of all sensors are required? Attitude control is required. See, you want to point the solar arrays, have to point to sun directly or at some angle, okay, otherwise power will not be generated. So you have, in fact there are solar panel sun sensors also there, some sensors directly mounted on solar panels which will track the sun, and the solar panel will accordingly rotate continuously to see the sun. Point antenna towards earth if you want to transmit, whenever you want to transmit the data, payload data, or even TTC antenna for telemetry and telecommand antenna, they have to point towards earth. If they look somewhere else, you will not get any data. Point payload cameras, of course we have explained earlier. Here important thing is the payload camera is looking down and taking pictures, okay. Even while taking pictures also, it has to be stable. Suppose if it is going like this, satellite is going like this or like this, depending on the axis, okay, the image will get distorted. What is shown on the right side, effect of yaw error, effect of pitch error, and the effect of roll error, okay. So if suppose satellite is going like this, the camera satellite turned like this, okay, while going like this, that is called roll error. So the image, instead of seeing here somewhere, it will see somewhere else, you will get image. Pitch error means either the here or back, or yaw error, instead of a perfect bottom, it will get tilted actually. This is called yaw error. So like that, the errors will be there. Then orient thrusters for orbit maneuvers. Okay. So you have to tilt the, rotate the whole satellite in some orientation, and then fire thruster. So that also is very important. It is done for sensors. Then control heat dissipation. Avoid damage to sensitive components. Some of the components should not be exposed to sun. For example, directly sunside. We have sunside and anti-sunside. We define in the axis in the any satellite. So that orientation also is important. Of course, the accuracy varies from mission to mission. The accuracy varies. If you see this figure, depending on the mission, there are two important things for any satellite. One is position. Okay, in the orbit, the position of the satellite. Okay. In terms of x, y, z and velocity, okay, like a GPS. So the position is very important, and pointing, where it is pointing, exactly ideal pointing is there or some errors are. So if you see different missions, for example a space telescope like Hubble Space Telescope, etc. Okay, pointing knowledge, attitude is very important. Okay, it can be slightly, position is okay, but pointing, when it is pointing to a star, to study a star, okay, it has accurately, it should know it is pointing to that star only. If you see other extreme, if you see a GPS satellite, okay, GPS satellite pointing is not that important, but its own position to give correct position, okay, of vectors, its own position is very knowing knowledge about its own position. So others, if you see Earth observation missions in the middle, it is in between actually, but particularly when you go, yesterday I explained to you, with the higher the resolution, once you are going to 1 meter, 0.5 meter like that, okay, you have to very accurately point, otherwise the error itself will be some few meters, okay, then you will not get the correct picture what you want. Of course, the basic block schematic, Mr. Natarajan will explain in detail. Basically, the sensors mounted on the satellite, okay, they will measure the attitude errors. Actually, there are two types of sensors. One is actual error sensors, okay, absolute error they measure. Other one is rate sensors. See, the satellite is not stable, means rock stable. It will be slowly go, some rates it will be, it will going with the rate. So the rate of the satellite will also be measured. There are rate sensors, mostly gyroscopes. Okay. So both, of course, rate sensor you have to integrate for some intervals, time intervals you have to integrate, so that you get the d theta by dt, theta you will get. So that error is given, and you know the ideal pointing, okay, what is required pointing. So the difference between the two, what is pointing right now and what is ideal, that is the error. So the error is fed to the control electronics. Control electronics, depending on the polarities and magnitude, it will give the, it will actuate, give the signal to actuators. Different act like magnetometer or react will be reaction wheels, okay, about three axis wheels will be rotated. Okay. So the momentum transfer will take place, wheel speed either you increase accordingly the satellite will be correcting. Okay. The error, suppose some error is there, you correct it slowly, it will come back to correct ideal position. This is the basic block diagram. These are the typical requirements. Okay. Yaw error 0.05 degree, particularly for high resolution missions, satellite of the order of 0.4, and rate will be of the order of 10 to the power of minus 4 degree, minus 4 to minus 5 degree per second. It's a very low rate actually. Okay, that is the type of rates. And communication satellites, so they don't need as much accurate pointing because you have wide communication beams, you know, signals, so you can receive from the ground antennas. So the requirements of communication satellites, INSAT and all that, will be slightly poorer than remote sensing satellites. But whatever you measure with these sensors, okay, normally it will not be exactly what is the error. Okay, the ideally, if you see an ideal measurement, a linear linear line, if you take, which says actual value and the measured value are both are same. Okay. It will never happen. There will be some error. Basically, there are two types of errors in the measurements. One is systematic errors. Okay. There will be some bias. Suppose the sensor, as I told, when you mounted on the satellite, instead of like this, slightly there is an error. Okay. But that is fixed. So that is treated as a bias. Then scale factor, nonlinearity, systematic error. Only thing is systematic errors, you can quantify, you know. Okay. And then you can subtract them, you can take out or add or subtract from the actual measurement. But there are some random errors, okay, particularly related to electronics, noise, etc. Okay. That random errors will be varying with time, they are not constant. Only thing is that also you can minimize, you cannot totally eliminate, you can minimize by filtering, by averaging over a time period. So many samples you take, average you take, so that the error is minimized. So when I come to types of attitude sensors, earth sensors, I will explain one by one. Sun sensors, there are star sensors, magnetometers, fiber optic gyroscopes. Okay, there are two types of gyroscope. One is mechanical gyroscope, where a wheel rotates. Okay, about three axis, three wheels will be rotating, and then that wheel itself is mounted on a gimbal. Okay, it is not fixed; it's a gimbal. So once the satellite rotates, the gimbal, it will rotate in the other direction. So the rotation of gimbal will be picked up, that gives the error. That is a mechanical gyroscope. And MEMS, micro electromechanical sensors, nowadays because miniaturization is happening, so MEMS sensors are widely used in the, particularly in the nanosatellites. So all these sensors, by name itself you have seen sun sensor, earth sensor, like that. So each sensor will take that particular celestial object, okay, as a reference. See, when you are pointing to, when the satellite is in orbit, it doesn't know where it is looking, where it is orienting. So it has to take for earth pointing. Okay. Even for earth pointing, you can take some star or sun as a reference, and then other axis you define like that. So for sun sensor, sun is the reference. Basically, one advantage is it is very bright object. Sun is there. And it requires very low power because you need not amplify, the signal itself will be high. So the sun sensors are low power and low weight. Only thing is, sun sensor, when the satellite goes behind the earth, eclipse. Okay, sun is here. If it goes behind, it cannot see the sun. So during eclipse, the sun sensors cannot give any output. Similarly, earth sensors. Okay, earth sensors, there are different types of sensors, I have explained. Magnetic field, of course, Mr. Guptaji has already explained the magnetometer, okay, how it measures the Earth's magnetic field and gives the output. Star sensor are the best sensors for accurate pointing. because the stars depend, you know, of all the objects, stars are the smallest, okay, when you get. So even a small error you can detect with a smaller object, so you will get very high accuracy. Then inertial space, that's what, gyroscopes, the rate sensors. Coming to earth sensors, basically they work on this principle. See, you know, the earth is surrounded by atmosphere. In the atmosphere, the carbon dioxide is there in the atmosphere. So the property of carbon dioxide is, the from the solar radiation, it will absorb infrared radiation in the 14 to 16 micrometer band, 14 to 16 micron band. It absorbs carbon dioxide and then it emits also immediately. So like a black body, whatever I'm talking, it emits also. So that signal in that band of 14 to 16 microns, the earth sensor works. What happens? It will scan from the satellite. It will scan and it will look at that at that height. Okay. So the space is at 4 degrees Kelvin. You know, very cold space. So when you are scanning, okay, from the cold space, when it enters the signal, that the atmosphere, it will immediately sense this 14 to 16 micron band and the signal will be high. Okay. Till that time, the low signal will be there. And when it crosses the earth, I will explain. There are, of course, two different types of scans. Basic principle is same. GeoSat satellites from geostationary orbit, okay, what they do is they do linear scans. Okay. If your earth is like this, globe from the geostationary, one north, okay, from east to west, like that it scans, and one from south towards south side, it will measure. Okay. There will be two scans is shown there. So what will happen is, when you are scanning, if the satellite has no error, ideally this and this width will be same. Okay. This width and this width will be same. But if the satellite is error, some error, roll error is there, this will come down into the earth and this will go out of the earth. Okay. So this width will increase because of earth, you know, circular. From the top it comes bottom towards equator, so it will be more like that. So, and the other thing is the center, instead of, suppose there is a pitch error, instead of like this error, so one side will go side, so the center of the this width, okay, it will shift this way or this way. So from this they measure the both roll and pitch errors. In LEO satellites, like nano satellites or IRS satellites, etc., there will be a conical scanning. Okay. On the satellite, there will be earth sensor. Okay. It will have a small motor which is rotating. So the signal will be, you know, the scanning will be done conically. Okay. So while doing the scan like this, here is the earth. So this is all cold space. Once it comes to the earth, at the atmosphere, it will see that much width. Okay. To the atmosphere, again it will go back to space. Like that, it will be scanning. So earth sensor, that's what. But only thing is that the sensor construction wise, see, because it is a infrared band, the sensor has to use germanium optics lenses and prisms. Okay, normal glass lenses will not work to pass the radiation. So germanium material is used for making the sensor optics. These are the typical parameters of a sensor, weight, etc. But only thing is, you can see the accuracy with this earth sensors typically of the order of 0.1 degree, 0.1, 0.15 degree accuracy only you will get with the earth sensors. For this is a way of testing. How do you test the earth sensor on ground? Okay, you cannot so you have to simulate an extended some black object will be there. Okay, black painted. So that will be like 300 degree Kelvin of earth temperature you simulate, and then scan. Okay, do the scanning and simulate the errors and measure the output. Second sensor is sun sensor, second type of sensor. Sun sensors, they take the sun as the reference. Okay, and then there are, of course, sun sensor, different types of configurations are there. 4 pi sun sensors, which measures four, why it's called 4 pi is, 4 pi means all 360 degrees total sphere. So the sensors on any satellite, the sensors are mounted on all the faces, okay, on four sides, so that any satellite orientation, whatever be the satellite orientation, one sensor head or other, it will see the sun. So from that they will derive the attitude. This is a type of sensor called digital sensor. Here there will be it's a quad glass will be there. Okay. And the bottom it's a block of glass. Bottom there will be detector. Okay. Some which is pattern will be there. Will be the sinusoidal basically 90 degree offset between the two. That pattern will be there. Okay. Consecutive pattern. There will be an offset of 90 degrees so that both sine and cosine signal you will get once, and on the top there will be a slit. One slit will be there. So when sun passes through the sun rays, then it will fall on the bottom detector pattern, and you will get the sine and cosine output. So by an algorithm, you measure the roll and pitch errors. So this is a typical digital sensor, and here of course you get better accuracy than 4-pi sensor. 4-pi sensor gives very coarse accuracy of the order of 2-degree, 3-degree type of thing. Whereas here, in digital sensor, you get almost 0.5 degree type of accuracy you can get. And the other sun sensors, solar panel sun sensors. I told you they are directly mounted on the solar panel. Okay. So when the solar panel rotates, for example, when it goes into eclipse, there is no sun. So what we do? You stop the solar panel, don't rotate it. Okay. When it comes out of eclipse, what happens? 35 minutes eclipse. So the satellite would have rotated, but solar panels got stuck. They were stopped at some angle. So then it has to again get the sun, track the sun. So fast it will rotate, and then once it sees the sun, it will again converge. It will stop, and then onwards it will continuously track the sun. Similarly, 4-pi sensors, I explained. There is another type of sensor called active pixel sun sensor. Okay. Basically, here the principle is you have a active pixel array, okay, two-dimensional CCD array type of thing. So basically, CMOS array. So, and you have on the top, okay, there is a small pinhole will be there. Bottom, detector will be there. So, depending on the direction. The error, satellite, error, the sun will be falling, sun rays. So, on whichever pixel it falls, or a set of pixels, okay, from that you measure the attitude. Both x and y coordinates, you can find, in terms of line and pixel numbers, you can locate the center of this thing, image, and then from that derive the attitude. So, this is a typical simulator. You see, there are sun simulators with a xenon arc lamps. You simulate the actual sun in the laboratory. Only thing is the intensity of sun, actual sun, you cannot simulate. Okay. So what we do is we correlate a constant, okay, between the sun simulator and the actual sun. So you do the calibration in the laboratory, then you put a filter on that. Okay. After the calibration is over, we put a optical filter with a coating. So that when it sees the actual sun, the signal will be attenuated. Otherwise, it will saturate and the detector may get spoiled also. So you have to attenuate that much. We call it neutral density filter. One neutral density filter will be put so that the signal is attenuated. This is the most important star sensor. Now, almost early, of course, basically they were available earlier in bigger sizes. We were flying in our own satellites. But when there is a demand for high pointing accuracy for nanosat small satellites, the technology is now they are miniaturizing the star sensor also. Okay. So many of the nanosatellites nowadays they are flying with a star sensor. Star sensor basically it is like a camera. Okay. One lens will be there and one detector will be there. Okay. Two dimensional array, again detector will be there. What will happen is it will be looking at the stars. This basically star sensor you have to mount on the satellite such that neither the sunlight, okay, sunlight should not enter star sensor, or some earth reflection also should not go into star sensor. You have to orient this star sensor like that. Otherwise, what will happen? Star sensor basically you are looking into space towards the stars. So the space is totally dark, and the light coming from stars is so feeble. Okay. So if some sunlight enters, then that will whole, you know, it will saturate background and you cannot detect the stars. Okay. That's why most of the star sensors will have a baffle, what is called a baffle. You can see the white portion. Okay. So it will like a camera, you know, shade type of thing. So it will even sunlight enters at some angle, it will not directly fall on the lens. It will fall in the baffle, then some multiple reflections will take place, and mostly it is black painted, okay, blackened, so that it will not get, it will get attenuated totally. When it reaches the detector, the reflected light is very low. So basically here the principle is, I mean the construction is, you have a lens and you have a detector, so the output is taken, and there will be two, actually in the detector there will be two areas, one is the imaging area, other one is a memory area, same number of pixels and will be there both. So when you you take a snapshot of one set of stars, transfer it to the memory area, so the, from the memory area the processor will be get processing. Okay, how it processes I will tell you. So then next exposure will be happening. When processing is going on in the memory area, next exposure of stars will be happening. See, here what happens is, see, for example a star, one single star is imaged on the detector. Okay. Purposefully, by design, what they do is they slightly defocus the lens. Okay, it is not perfect, for sharp image will not be made, it is slightly defocused, so that a single star will image slightly blur, like a blur on few pixels. Okay, on few pixels it will be there. From that they will compute the centroid, what is the centroid of the that star image. Okay. So by computing centroid you will get fraction of a pixel by derivation. Okay, by mathematical derivation you will get, including a fraction of a pixel, okay, you can get that is the actual center. So that is centroid computation is very important and very robust algorithms. Then attitude determination, what the basic principle of star sensor is, there is a star catalog. Okay, what are the stars? Okay, catalog is stored in the onboard memory, there will be memory in that all the stars are cataloged. And the second important thing is the star sensor is designed to detect up to certain magnitude of the star. Magnitude is related to brightness of the star. Okay, zero magnitude is very bright, first magnitude, second magnitude, like that if you go fifth magnitude up to fifth, normally up to fifth or sixth magnitude only the star sensor can detect. Beyond sixth magnitude the still the light, you know, very feeble, you cannot even see. Up to fifth magnitude stars only will be seen. So that number of stars will be stored in the catalog. Then when you mount the star sensor on the satellite, okay, so we know a priori, suppose the satellite at any instant, okay, if it is having zero errors, the roll pitch yaw, there is no error at all, zero, then this many star, these are the stars will be in the field of view, that is known. So what they will do, they will compute, okay, from the actual, you that pixel line numbers you know, but you will get the actual pixel and line numbers, okay. The difference between the two they compute as attitude errors. Okay. But only thing is, first time when you expose, like we call it a lost in space mode. Okay, first time when you switch on, it doesn't know where it is. So it will, with respect to this one snap, it will take, let us say. So those stars, it will look for the entire catalog and nearby, like a pattern matching, it will do. That's called search mode. So once the pattern matches, okay, this star like that. Again on the catalog also you see, once the pattern matches it will go into track mode. Okay, it will track that those stars and then compute the attitude. So this is a sensor frame with respect to, you have a reference frame stored. Okay, then you transform, do the transformation and compute the attitude. Okay, see the advantage of this detector, particularly earlier they were using charge coupled devices, but later they changed over to active pixel sensors where you can out the output readout can be done each pixel wise, you can do readout, you need not do you know line or column wise, each pixel you can, so you form a window wherever there is a star, you just 5 pixel by 5 pixel make
in windows, around each star you make a window, okay, then you read only those, so that the time is saved, processing time will be faster. So like any other sensor, see, all sensors, the important thing is on ground before launch you have to calibrate each sensor. Calibration means for this much input, okay, this is the output. Suppose you simulate error 0.1 degree, this is the output, 0.2 degree, this is the output, then you make a this one scale factor for this, then from the output you have to derive the error. Once it is in orbit you get output, from that you have to derive the error. So you have to do a calibration. For which star sensor, there are very high accuracy star simulators are there with a long collimator, the actual stars will be simulated. Okay, so with respect to the stars, you point the sensor towards the collimator and do the calibration. Other very accurate gyroscope, as I explained, there is a mechanical gyroscope, but another option is fiber optic gyroscope. Fiber optic gyroscope, basic principle is you have a very long, some kilometers of fiber wound, okay. Then you have the two ends of the fiber, you pass two laser beams, okay, through the each end, okay. So they will be traveling in that full length, each beam in opposite directions, okay. When they meet, there will be an interference. Interference will take place between the two beams and you will get some fringes. But if you keep static the sensor, that ring, you keep it static, you will get constant fringes. But you keep it this ring on a platform and rotate the platform, okay, then what happens, one beam, okay, you are rotating, whichever is beam you are taking, that will be shorter distance, travel a shorter distance, the other opposite direction will be taking a longer route. So there will be change in the fringe pattern. That is called a Sagnac effect, okay. This is the principle. So when the satellite, it is mounted on the satellite and satellite rotates, okay, so you will know what is the rate, by what rate it is satellite is rotating, you measure the rate from the this output. Of course it gives these are all the specifications of a fiber optic gyro, 0.01 degree per hour, that is the rate, okay, you get, that is stable, of course bias stability. Then the angular random walk, 0.004 degree per root hour, okay. Of course the sampling is at 10 hertz. This is a typical nano satellite, it's okay, ISRO nano satellite developed by ISRO Satellite Center, okay. So here also you can see the sensors, various sensors mounted. Of course these are all the, we have flown star sensor, then force analog sensor, magnetometer, different types of sensors were used in this. Thank you.
So what is the difference between this sun sensor and 4-pi sun sensor?
As I said, 4-pi sensor also is a sun sensor basically. It depends on the field of view of the sensors. Okay. 4-pi sensor, the field of view is 4-pi steradians. Okay. Steradians, you know, steradian is a solid angle. In a solid angle, if you take a cone, the cone angle, if you see, that is one solid angle, it is expressed in steradians. So this 4-pi sensor is having 360, means the entire globe around the satellite full, okay, wherever sun is there, that this 4-pi sensor will see. It's not a single sensor by name 4-pi single, but it will have multiple heads, okay, with the solar cells. It is mounted on the satellite. Suppose satellite you imagine as a cuboid, it is mounted on this face, all, okay, all faces it will be mounted. So wherever satellite orientation, some heads will see the sun, okay, some two heads, three heads will see the sun. From that they will compute the angle. That is called 4-pi. Other sun sensors will have a limited field of view. That is the difference.
Star sensor or star sensor, just to get to, so why?
No, actually I am not competent to answer your question on Chandrayaan 2. that we will discuss later. Whatever knowledge we have, we are okay, that we will discuss later, because we also have limited knowledge on that. We are not actively involved in Chandrayaan.